तो डॉक्टर सोशन, नाउ यू कैन स्टार्ट योर लेक्चर।
हेलो, कैन यू हियर?
यस
गुड मॉर्निंग फ्रेंड्स, आम आई ऑडिबल? ओके, सो गुड मॉर्निंग डियर डॉक्टर्स एंड वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू टू दिस 30th लेक्चर ऑफ साधना सीरीज विच इज गोइंग ऑन सिंस लास्ट फ्यू मंथ्स। एंड आई एम वेरी हैप्पी टू बी हियर विथ यू टुडे। आई एम डॉक्टर के वी शॉयसन। I'm a senior consultant at Predictive Homeopathy, Kochi, as well as I have my clinic called Samagra Homeopathic Hospital at Alua. And I also thank all the senior faculties who have taken lectures in Sadhana series to continue the mission of Vijayakar sir. So let's start. So before we begin, let's take the blessings of Master Hanuman, who has given us this beautiful science of nature. And let's also take the blessings of our guru, Dr. Praful Vijaykar sir, who has taught us how to practice homeopathy mathematically, and he has shown excellent results in the so-called incurable cases, and he has lived as an example of how a homeopath should be. So let's take such blessings. Let me take the blessings of my grandfather, who was a homeopath, late Dr. Krishna Panikkar. Let me also take the blessings of my parents, homeopaths, Dr. Vijayanand and Dr. Rajalakshmi. Friends, before I begin, I would like to show which I think is very important today. So why do I stand firm with predictive homeopathy in the last 20 years? So these are certain things. I'm sharing with you only the most important things with you, because there are 100 reasons why I stand firm with predictive homeopathy, but this is the most important 10 out of them. So this is only for the beginners. If any one of you are new to predictive homeopathy, or you are beginners, this is for you, because all the seniors already know about it. Okay, so let's start. The number one reason: Dr. Vijaykar was the only homeopath in the world to show consistent results in the so-called incurable cases. See, fortunately, I had the opportunity to have exposure to many schools of homeopathy, many stalwarts of homeopathy, and I have been with them. I have attended their classes. Because I have already told you, my grandfather was homeopath, my parents are homeopath, so I had the opportunity to be with many of the senior homeopaths in Kerala and outside. So among them, I have seen only has given consistent results in the so-called incurable cases. Of course. Everybody has results, no doubt about that, and I'm thankful to all of them. But it's only because sir, who has shown consistent results in incurable, so-called incurable cases, which are written off by all the other methods. Number two, he was the only homeopath to explain Herring's law scientifically, based on embryology, which is essential in the follow-up. You must have already learned this in explained Herring's law on the basis of embryology, and that is very important because initially, before I come to I was wondering how this Herring's law can be in many cases. Of course, in certain cases it is easy, but in majority of the cases, there was no scientific basis. Now, for example, if a person comes with the uterine fibroid and we give a medicine, then in the follow-up, the patient comes with an ovarian cyst, then how do we decide whether it's a good follow-up or bad follow-up? So it's only after coming to predictive homeopathy and learning on the basis of embryology that the ovary is in the fifth layer and the uterus is in the third layer, I was able to differentiate the follow-up, and accordingly I could change the medicine or continue the medicine. So this is applicable in all the cases. It's very important in applying this in all the cases. And number three, his explanation of miasms as three defensive mechanisms has made it easy to learn and practice. When I was studying in the college, I was taught miasms. Even you were also taught miasms, but it was totally confusing that which is psora, which is psychosis, and which is syphilis. There was no clear-cut demarcation, or there was no definite criteria to differentiate the miasms. But this explanation that all these three miasms are three defensive mechanisms of our body. This has made it very easy and very simple. Now we know whatever symptoms we found, whatever physical symptoms, whatever mental character we find, it is very easy for us to differentiate. And number four, predictive is the only school of homeopathy that stands firm with Hahnemann and has not deviated from what Hahnemann has taught us in Organon. And moreover, Dr. Vijayakar sir has explained Hahnemann with more clarity. Yes, this is one of the major reasons I follow predictive homeopathy, because in this school of homeopathy, we have not deviated from a single point what Hahnemann has put forward. And also, sir has explained it with more clarity because the language in Organon is very tough and very difficult for the common man to understand. But sir has explained it in such a simple language that we quite often we come to know the new things whenever we attend sir's lecture. Sir will come up with a new thing, but it's already there in Organon, but we never understood that. Number five, he taught us homeopathy is mathematics and proved it in his practice. So In all the lectures, sir says homeopathy is mathematics. It's very simple to practice, but it's not only a lecture. He has proved it in his practice, and he has showed us n number of results to substantiate that homeopathy is mathematics. It's so accurate. And number six, he was the only homeopath to produce up to 80% results in the difficult cases which were solved on the stage. Stage means we were attending the SEPH plus lectures for the past 3 or 4 years in Mumbai. So every day on the stage, sir was solving cases, live cases, almost 7 to 8 cases per day. And all of them, cancers, autism, mental retardation, and so many whatnot. So next, when we come for the, after 2 months, when we come for the next session, the follow-ups were taken and we were shown that in the follow-up, at least 80% of the cases were improved. It was mind-blowing. And number seven, I could witness the same results whenever I attended Sir's clinic. I had the opportunity to attend Sir's clinic in Mumbai. I'm very fortunate. So whenever I attended, the same results, almost up to 80%. Sirs, as you all know, Sirs is only difficult cases, only highly syphilitic cases were seen by Sir. So there also, I could witness the outstanding results. And number eight, the first and only homeopath to reveal the mind behind pathologies. As you all know, now we solve cases after exploring what is the mental conflict behind the whatever pathology the patient is presenting with us. So this was given to the world by Sir in homeopathy. Number nine, the first and only homeopath to declare that homeopathic medicine is positron based and is part of immaterial world. So this was an outstanding revelation, because I never knew that homeopathy, such an explanation can be given, as such a scientific explanation can be given. Because now the most difficult part with homeopathy, when we talk with the other scientific world, is that homeopathy is not scientific and all. But the explanation which Sir has given, Sir said this is positron based and it is part of the immaterial world. Okay, this is something maybe new to many of you, but probably some of the other lectures may come up in a session to teach you further. I'm not going to detail with that because our topic is different. So, and number 10, the only homeopath who has given new life to lakhs of families by curing the incurable illnesses of differently abled children through free medical camps called Hope for the Hopeless, still going on all over India, including in Kerala. We are also running 5 camps in different parts of Kerala. So all those cases, all these camps are filled with difficult cases of differently abled children, and all these, they are given a completely free of medicine, free consultation. Thousands of cases are being attended in a single camp with outstanding results. So I don't think anyone, any homeopath in the world was doing that. So friends, these are only just 10 reasons to follow predictive homeopathy. So if anyone is new listening to this, it will be helpful for them. So let's pass on to our topic today. So let's start with a case of childhood aphasia. A boy of 3.5 years came on 4/10/2019 with delayed speech. He was unable to speak any word clearly and could make only some indistinct sounds. So this boy was not at all able to speak. He was 3.5 year male child. So speech was affected. This child was born normal after 2 miscarriages. The mother had 2 miscarriages, and after that, this was the 3rd child, which was born with normal delivery. All milestones are normal except speech. He could grasp things easily. He was an intelligent child. He was afraid of being alone. He was very careful and attentive in doing things. A diligent child, but very obstinate. He wanted someone, especially mother, to do every little things for him. So even though fearful, he was intelligent and very careful in attending doing things. But whatever he does, he wants his mother to be with him. He was very timid to mingle with strangers. At home, he is very free. He is mingling with anyone at home. And he is also very angry at home if his will is not satisfied. But obeys if parents raise voice. Okay, so the child is angry. But if the parents raise little voice, he is ready to obey. So that's his character. And he always liked to watch TV when mother is in kitchen. Otherwise, he wants to be with mother. So whenever he is not watching TV, he wants to be always to hang around with mother. Doesn't allow mother to go anywhere else. So he is very much attached to her. Has to touch mother always, especially while in bed. So he cannot sleep without touching her. He weeps with fear if mother is far away, but tries not to show his feelings to others. He lives in the middle of discords in family. There are fights between parents, and the child is a silent victim of it. So the parents fight each other, and there are hot arguments, and this child was a silent victim of it. And the mother's life, her father-in-law married another lady after the death of his wife. This lady was hostile with her and dominated her. Husband was also not supportive. So mother had a miserable life. So this history is before the birth of this child. The father-in-law, means husband's father, married another lady. So this lady was not in good relation with this child's mother, and they were fighting. And this lady's husband, our patient's mother's husband, was also not supportive with her. And it was during this time that the miscarriages took place, the first two miscarriages. And now the pregnancy conflict of this child. Her husband was very rude and obstinate. He used to dictate terms, and she had to obey without any protest. She said he did not listen to her words at all. So the mother told me that my husband was very rude and very obstinate, so he did not listen to me. Whatever I say, he did not listen. So he was very dominant and dictatorial. And she said she did not have a say in that house. So there was no point in saying anything to him, because he has his own way of doing things. So I was not listened. I had my strong opinions, but I was forced to keep within myself. So this lady was having her own opinions. She was not a yielding lady, but she had her opinions. But it was not at all possible because the husband was so domineering. I felt thoroughly disappointed because of this. Okay, and husband was very angry and short-tempered. So I had to suppress my desires and emotions to avoid open fight. It was only after birth of this child that I started to fight with them. So after a few years, after the birth of this child, then she started fighting with him. But during the pregnancy, she did not fight because she wanted to avoid such situations at home, and she had to suppress her desires and emotions. The child is hot and thirstless. So this is a very short case. A remedy was given, and then the follow-up was on 27-12-2019. He started speaking few words. Earlier he was not even able to speak a word. Now he started speaking few words. Obstinacy also reduced, fear reduced, started doing things without mother being around. So he started doing things without mother means his fear has reduced. And again, after 7 months, that is on 23-7-20, now he started speaking more words. Now he is able to communicate well with parents. So it took only about 8 to 9 months to solve this case. So now this child is absolutely normal and he is speaking. Okay, now let's come to the analysis and the rubric selection. So what all rubrics are coming, or how do we analyze this case? What are your suggestions? Okay, yeah, Dr. Vanasri has suggested clinging to mother. Okay, then anyone else? Okay, we have delirium quiet by Dr. Shubha Tos. Okay. Anyone else? Okay, please come up with your views. Timidity, strangers in presence of. Okay. From Dr. Sangeeta Thakur. By Dr. Himangdi Bhatia. Okay. Mother avoiding to talk. Okay. Mother in pregnancy. Okay. Okay. So let's go to the analysis. So the rubrics I have taken are number one, libertinism, and number two, clinging. So why libertinism? I have taken this rubric because sir has shown a similar case during an SEPH Plus session in Mumbai. It was almost a similar case, a child who was not developed speech. So the conflict was also similar, where the mother was not, the mother was restricted to talk and the mother was not allowed to express her views. So libertinism means what? Libertinism is a kind of freedom to do whatever you like or to speak whatever you like. So here, the freedom to express her views were aborted. So she was not allowed to talk because this lady was a kind of person who wanted her own liberty or who valued her liberty. So that's why this child was affected, because the mother was, if it was another lady, this problem would not have come, because the sensitivity is different in different individuals. So this particular lady, she valued her liberty and she was so much affected by the fact that my liberty is restricted, I am not allowed to speak. So the message given by this lady to the child is, there is no point in developing speech because nobody is going to listen to your speech. So why do, what is the need of speaking? So that is the message given by the mother to the child in her uterus, so that the speech of the child is affected. So that's why we have taken the rubric libertinism. And number two, as doctor has suggested, it is clinging. Dr. Vanasri Pawar, she has rightly pointed out, it is clinging. Why clinging? Because the child is unable to be away with the mother. He is so afraid that he is clinging. Clinging is an act of being attached to someone out of fear. So it says clinging is a delirial rubric. Even though it does not come under the heading delirium, this can be considered as a delirial rubric, because this patient is doing a kind of delirial act that he is clinging, clinging to his mother. So these two rubrics are combined. And let's see the repertorial analysis. We have stramonium, oncot, phosphorus, baryta carp, lycopodium, natremur, pulsatilla, and sepia. So how do you analyze now? Which remedy can come? Do you have any suggestions? Now it is very simple. We have only 8 remedies to differentiate. The child is intelligent, hot, thirstless, a coward. It's a clear case of lycopodium, because lycopodium is the only remedy here which is hot, thirstless, and diligent, who behaves as a coward and he's a boss in his house, but he is timid outside. So lycopodium was given and he has become normal. Let me try, I can share the video with you. Yeah, this is the case I can see.
ചെറിയ കുറുമ്പോളൊക്കെ ഉണ്ടെന്ന് ടീച്ചർ
പറഞ്ഞു.
ആ കുഴപ്പമില്ല, ആദ്യം 2 ദിവസം ഒന്നും ക്ലാസ്സിൽ ഇരിക്കൂലായിരുന്നു, ഓടി നടക്കുമായിരുന്നു, പിന്നെ ഇപ്പൊ ക്ലാസ്സിൽ ഇരിക്കും. ചിലപ്പോ ആള് അവിടെ നോക്കൂല, പക്ഷെ ശ്രദ്ധിക്കുന്നുണ്ടാവും, ആൻസർ ചെയ്യുമെന്ന് പറയുന്നു. ക്ലാസ്സിൽ അവളോടൊന്നും ചിലപ്പോ ടീച്ചർ നോക്കൂലായിരിക്കും, പക്ഷെ ചോദിച്ചാൽ ഉത്തരം പറയും. ആ ശരി, പിന്നെ കുറുമ്പളായിട്ടൊക്കെ ചെയ്ത് ഓടി നടന്നും അത് ഇതൊക്കെ തരടും അങ്ങനെയൊക്കെ ചെയ്യും. പിന്നെ നമ്മള് കരഞ്ഞാലൊക്കെ അവര് ഭയങ്കര വിഷമമാണ്, വിഷമം വരും, നമ്മുടെ മുഖമൊക്കെ മാറിയാൽ വളർപ്പ്. ഞാൻ എന്തെങ്കിലും അവനോട് ദേഷ്യപ്പെട്ടാൽ അപ്പോൾ തന്നെ അവൻ പറയും അവൻ്റെ മുഖം മാറി, ബാസി ബാക്കി ആരും ദേഷ്യപ്പെട്ടാലും കുഴപ്പമില്ല, എന്തെങ്കിലും അങ്ങനെ ചെയ്യലോ ബാസി വടിയെടുക്കുന്നൊക്കെ പറഞ്ഞാൽ നമുക്ക് വിഷമം.
Okay, so I was not able to share it in the screen share, but see in this video, the mother, she was talking in Malayalam. I don't know how many of you understand Malayalam, so I'll just translate. So she was saying, the child now, he answers the questions, he is able to communicate well, he has also started attending the nursery and he interacts with the teacher as well. That's it. So let me, I will show you one more video. Now the child is speaking.
White.
White mitai. Okay. എന്നെന്താ വേണ്ടത്? എത്ര തവണ മുട്ടായി? എത്ര മുട്ടായി
വേണം?
റെഡ് മിഠായി. ഓക്കെ.
Yeah, so he's answering my questions very fluently. So this was video was taken about 4-5 months back. So now he has again improved. He's become quite normal. So now let's learn the matriomedica. Let's learn the trimiasmatic matriomedica of Lacopodium. So this I have taken from Sir's lectures in whatever books Sir has given, as well as the SCPH notes. So there's nothing from outside. So everything belongs to Sir. So this is the triad of Lycopodium, which Sir has given in the frequent encounters. So this is very important. So this is how we enter Lycopodium, or when a patient presents in front of us, this is the first point what we have to look into for selecting Lycopodium. So among the Lycopodium is hot, thirstless, and he loves warm food, and he is right sided. So these are the entry points, and then he is very angry, very haughty, and loves power, yet emotional. Lycopodium is an angry, but his anger does not go to that extent of destroying someone or attacking someone, or does not go into a syphilitic magnitude, but he generally is angry and very haughty. And because he loves power yet emotional, the need of Lycopodium is power, because he likes respect. The basic need is respect, so he loves powerful positions where people respect him. So that is the need of Lycopodium. So we can find Lycopodium in such senior posts, and in the leadership ladder, this Lycopodium will be always in the top, because he loves to have, loves to be in such positions where people respect him. He is hard on inferiors and soft with superiors. So this is basically like a podium. He has a coward tendency. He is fearful. So, but he tries to boss upon others who are inferior to him. But he is soft with superiors because he does not have that much courage to be hard with superiors like our Tarantulas and Callies. Again, he is very conscientious and diligent person. He is very diligent. He does his work without any laziness, and as he wants to progress in life, and he is an achiever because he is very conscientious and diligent. He is not a lazy or not idle one. He is a hardworking who is very ambitious and achieving things in life. And let's see how about the appearance of Lyco, the physical appearance, the miasmatic differences. So how is the Sauric Lyco? Sauric Lyco is a timid child who is very shy and clings to mother. Frown on face can be seen on adults as well. This is a Sauric clinging I am talking about. Horizontal and vertical furrows on forehead. So just by seeing the furrows also, one can differentiate the remedies. So in the case of Lycopodium, it will be horizontal and vertical furrows. In the case of Naxomygia and Ammonium Carb, it will be vertical furrows only. There will not be horizontal furrows. And if it is psychotic Lyco, the upper part of body is emaciated and lower part is semi-dropsical. So he has very emaciated chest and neck, all these parts will be emaciated, and the lower part, the abdomen and down the thighs and all will be swollen and semi-dropsical like. So this is the classical appearance of psychotic Lyco. And the lower part of cheeks is fatty with double chin. And when it comes to the syphilitic Lycopodium, the appearance can be effeminate appearance. The male Lycopodium will have some feminine appearance. So that is a syphilitic Lycopodium. So this is only for the physical appearance differentiation. And now let's go to the other general characteristics of Lycopodium. Ailments from anger, egotism, anticipation, foreboding, and anxiety, grief. So these are the things which Lycopodium which have ailments from, because he is very angry and very haughty. So he has high ego, very anticipatory. Especially for any audience or any examinations before, he is very anxious, for he has forebodings, anxiety and grief. And anger with silent grief is also marked in Lycopodium. Physically bean-shaped face with prominent bossing of forehead. Prominent bossing of the forehead is another characteristic feature of Lycopodium. And the body language, he sits erect with folded hands on chest. Diligent and intelligent, as I already told you. Then he is very domineering, obstinate, egoistic, haughty and strong-willed. He is very domineering, as I told you, domineering especially with those who are below him, those who are inferior to him, and very obstinate in his opinions, very egoistic, very haughty and strong-willed person. At the same time, very covert and weak-willed. Actually, Lycopodium is covert and weak-willed internally, but the thing is that we may not be able to identify his covertness and weak-will because he covers his feelings inside and he shows a different facet outside. Because he is very intelligent, he is able to do that in a very intelligent manner. We will not come to know that internally he is covered and weak-willed because he will be presenting himself different than what actually he is. So that is the specialty of Lycopodium. And they like literary and scientific work like tuberculinum, sulfur, acids. They're very, because these people are very intelligent, they prefer doing this literary scientific work and they excel in that. And the need is respect. And contradiction, intolerant of, is very marked in Lycopodium. They cannot, because contradiction makes them, they feel they are insulted because they feel, their feeling is that I am a very superior person. So if somebody is not listening to them, they feel I am insulted or not respected. They cannot tolerate the contradiction. And reaction to contradiction is anger. This is also very important. How different remedies react to react in different situations. Because see, the reaction Lycopodium cannot tolerate contradiction. But how do they react? The reaction is anger. All the other remedies did not react in anger. Some people is silent. Even though they cannot tolerate contradiction, some of the remedies will be silent because they suffer inside. But this Lycopodium, they express anger. And it is an esteemed remedy, so doesn't like consolation. So Lycopodium does not like consolation at all. So when to think of Lycopodium? When we see people who have a never smiling face, they have a serious appearance. People who look down upon others, people they who are very haughty and they look down upon others because they consider them as big people and they consider others as low level. They are very straightforward. Who love power, always complaining and discontent, like platina, ammoniums, and ipecac. So they are not satisfied easily. They have always complaining that this is not good, that is not right, and they are always discontented people who keep on criticizing others. So the level of satisfaction is very high, so they always criticize and they put down others. And they have this contemptuous tendency also. So the contemptuous is something syphilitic. Yes? So contemptuous means they you consider others as very very low people and you hurt their esteem. So contemptuous is syphilitic. They are very studious and conscientious. So they study well because they are intelligent and they are diligent. So they always, like a problem, people are very good and they score high marks. They are hard and inferior and soft and superior, already we have discussed. Disputatious and quarrelsome. Always they dispute with others, with their opinion, and they engage into a quarrel. Very timid but good boy image. So we can see some many times that Lycopodium have a timid and very good boy image. They listen, because they have a good boy image, because they listen to their parents and they listen to their teachers, because they are inferior in such situations, but they present that I am a very good boy. those who can't take a joke, they feel insulted easily. Even for silly jokes, they feel insulted. So they can't take a joke because their ego is very high. Those who can't take any dominance, they will not allow others to dominate them because they are I am the boss. I cannot let anyone dominate me. So that is the thought process of Lekha Podium. And shrieking, shouting can be seen. People have a stage fear. But Lekha Podium, the stage fear is only in the beginning. Once they start in the stage, they can excel well. They are very anticipatory and timid. So for going to the stage, they can rumble with fear, but they can stammer. But once they start, they do it better than anyone else. It's because of their intelligence. Hot, thirstless, right-sided. So the side is from right side to left side. So when the physical goes from right side to left side, the mental also will go to right side to left side. Both the half of the brain is active in Lekha Podium. And that's why in cases we know that it goes from left side to right side. So in Lekha Podium also, both hemispheres of the brain is active. In Lekha Podium is also active. So that's why they are very intelligent. And they desire warm food and drinks. The aggravation time is 4 to 8 p.m. that you all know. Flapping of LNSA. All this is another peculiarity where we can point out Lekha Podium. This wings of nose will be flapping when they breathe. Half opened eyes during sleep. It's another pointer where we can probe whether this patient is Lekha Podium. This will, our Lekha Podium patient will have history of renal stones, jaundice, this flatulence. There'll be always they have this flatulence and the abdomen will be bloated, nasal polyp, right sided, baldness, they have receding hairline like Beretta car, wrinkles on forehead, lean person like abrotanum, arsenic album, antimony crude, argentum nitricum, borax, Beretta carb, calcarea carb, Lekha Podium, sepia, cecal core, sulfur, all these are lean persons. So from the appearance itself, we may be able to differentiate, or this will be a pointer towards Lekha. Okay. The upper part is emaciated and lower part is semi-tropical. So this is the classical appearance of psychotic Lekha Podium. Even in acute cases, they present this feature. Once I had a case, I'll share with you. A small child of 6 years. So he suddenly he came up with retention of urine. He was not passing urine since 2 days. So this child was screaming like anything. He was clinging to mother, and there was not a single drop of urine was being passed. So the abdomen was bloated like anything. So on the first look I had with this child, it was a typical appearance of Lekha Podium, because the upper part was flat, his abdomen is swollen, and this child is screaming and clinging to mother. He was not letting his mother to go anywhere else. So he was crying and holding her hands. So within no time, Lekha Podium tandem was given. Within 5 minutes, after giving this Lekha Podium tandem one dose, within 5 minutes, the child ran to the toilet in my clinic itself. He ran to the toilet and he passed the complete urine, and he came out of the toilet smiling at me and thanking me. So such was the wonderful action of Lekha Podium. So what I'm trying to tell you is that even in the case of acute cases, sometimes we find the people present the Lekha Podium physical appearance. Predisposed to lung and hepatic disorders, they have this lithic acid diathesis, much red sediment in urine. So let's differentiate the mentals, the miasmatic mental differences of lycopodium. How is the psoric lycopodium? They present as very mild, very yielding, very quiet, very anxious, timid, and irritable. So all these qualities we find in psoric lycopodium. When it comes to the psychotic part, they can be very haughty. They can be characterless. They have who have no character or shameless, and they can be amorous, and they can be boaster. So why do they present with this psychotic mental disposition or the psychotic features? Because they want to defend the Sora. Sora taught us that all these three miasms are nothing but defensive mechanisms. So basically, we know lycopodium, the need of lycopodium is respect and power. So the need is Sora. So how do they defend the lycopodium? If they have sufficient respect and sufficient power, they may not go into the psychotic sphere. But if they are denied respect or their Sora is not satisfied, then the lycopodium will go into the psychotic defense mechanism, and there they want to boast. They want to they present as a haughty, because they will start telling that I am very knowledgeable person, or I am very connected to such and such persons, so I know these things. So they make themselves bigger than others who are around. So that is the boasting. So the reason behind boasting is they want to satisfy their ego, or they satisfy their need of respect. So this is the psychotic defense which lycopodium is presenting. And when it comes to syphilitic phase, everything goes out of control. Now this effeminate. Why the effeminate comes? Because there is confusion of identity, it's total confusion whether I am a male or I am a female. So that is syphilitic. And there can be syphilitic clinging. So as we have seen in this case, the clinging can be there, and they can present with severe rage, anger, uncontrollable anger, presentation of uncontrollable anger, that is rage, and again confusion of identity in various other things. So this is the syphilitic affection. So these are only few examples just I want to share with you. There are so many things which can be psychotic and syphilitic and psoric in lycopodium. These are just few examples, so that we what I am trying to tell you is that every remedy will have, especially the polycrest remedies, they have different phases of miasms when they come to us. Sometimes these patients will be coming to us with a psychotic predominant phase. Sometimes they will be coming with a syphilitic predominant phase. So no patient will ever come to us with all the features we have in our materia medica. That is an important lesson we have to learn. If they come to us with a syphilitic physical thing, their mind also will be in syphilitic phase. So we have to give importance to that syphilitic feature only. If there is nothing syphilitic, then you can catch hold of the psychosis. So all these things come when at a given time only we can see only one miasm which is predominant. I'm not saying there will not be other miasms, of course, but only the one miasm will be predominant. So we have to see the study the remedies according to the differences in niacins. Okay. So, if you have any doubt in this case, we will go to another case. Anyone wants to ask any question? Okay, so we'll go to this case. It's a case of primary generalized epilepsy. So a 24-year-old male came to me in January 2017. This was 4 years back, with frequent attacks of epileptic seizures. He was an engineer working in Mumbai. He was a Keralite who had his job in Mumbai. He was on Levipril 500 since 5 months. Attacks come with tonic-clonic seizures followed by loss of consciousness and stiffness of body. He had about 6 to 7 attacks during this period. So this was the case. This was a seizure disorder from 5 months. He was on Levipril 500 since 5 months. He never had any such attacks in the past. So this was something new. In the childhood, he never had any seizure disorder. And past history, he had recurrent attacks of tonsillitis at childhood. He gets the seizures when he's mentally stressed and also if he takes alcohol and drugs like marijuana. And now he stopped taking drugs and alcohol as he is sure he will have seizures. Okay. So he gets the seizures when he is mentally stressed and also if he takes alcohol and drugs like marijuana. He has a very much disturbed sleep since long time as he is not satisfied with his job. So he had some problems with his job and that was disturbing him since long time. He also has sneezing and nasal block when exposed to cold. Recurrent attacks of right shoulder joint dislocation since childhood. He has a history of sudden startling when he was 15 years old, when he used to spend hours using a laptop. So it was not a seizure, but he had a sudden startling when he used to spend hours using a laptop, that means with mental exertion. And he had recurrent attacks of asthmatic attacks up to 10 years. He had taken allopathy and homeopathic treatment. So father's history, father was having hypertension. Mother was very anxious, emaciated, and with recurrent urinary tract infection. In general, his appetite was good, desire spicy, non-vegetarian and oranges, aversion with odor of milk, history of urticaria from prawns, stool regular. In childhood, he has anticipatory stool, urine within normal limits, sweat was having yellow stain, dreams nothing particular, thermos chilly. And the regionals, he had burning eyes, aggravation sun, recurrent attacks of nasal blockage. He had map tongue, sensitivity, tickling sensation on touch, sensitive to shrill noise. And in mind and life situation, he was very good in studies and very competitive in all field, very impatient and angry if things are not getting done as he wanted. So again, this patient was very good in studies and very competitive in all the fields. Very impatient and angry if things are not getting done as he wanted. So very impatient and angry patient. Attached to mother, that is a sentimental attachment. Very ambitious, very fast paced in nature, hasty speech, very extroverted, very talkative, and very curious. So he always wanted to know how things are working. So he used to ask me how homeopathy is working, what are the principles of homeopathy, how the medicines are made. So he wanted to know all these things, and he was a very hardworking and ambitious. He always want to go ahead in life. So he had a passion to go ahead in life. My room is untidy but want cleanliness in bathroom and eating table. Hobbies: reading, traveling, dogs. I don't like others to interfere in my thing. So he doesn't like interference. He wants to be independent and separate in doing things. Wants mother near when he is sick. Often abusive. So the TPR from mother, he was not so studious type, but he gets good marks and high positions everywhere. So mother's version is that he does not study daily, like the results come, he has very good marks and he has high positions everywhere, not only in studies, even in games as well as in other co-curricular activities, he will be a winner. And he has a habit of being offended very easily. He does not stand any jokes at him. Very angry and very obstinate. It's very difficult to manage him because he is very angry and obstinate. Yes. So what can be our analysis? How do we go with this case? What are the rubrics you suggest? So if you all can share first, we can go to the discussion of this case. Any suggestions? Yes, exactly. He has a very sharp mind. Any other suggestions? He talks hastily. Yes, good. He is inquisitive with esteemed person. Very right. He is very ambitious, okay. Ambitious and curious, okay. Perspiration is turning yellow, okay. Milk aversion, okay. Startling aggravation, mental exertion, extrovert, competitive, actually he is not a primary extrovert, but he is very communicative. He is very talkative and communicative with the non-persons. Want mother when sick, competitive, dissatisfied, not satisfied with job. Okay, so we have a lot of rubrics. So all the rubrics which you all have suggested is right. There's no mistake in that. But such type of cases, especially in the last cases I have shown and in this case, so these are syphilitic cases. The first case was highly syphilitic. There was no speech. No speech means it is destruction of speech, so that is highly syphilitic. So we have to enter through only syphilitic rubrics. So this is a sorrow syphilitic case, what this seizure disorder. So here also we have to go with syphilitic rubric. So what is the syphilis here? That is what we have to probe. So the rubrics I have taken is convulsions, drugs after, and dislocation, extremities dislocation, EC. So I have told you he develops seizure disorders after he started using drugs like marijuana. So his body is so sensitive to the drugs that he gets seizure disorders. So that is a syphilitic reaction. So otherwise, if it was a soric reaction, he could have developed some other soric symptoms only. So now he has developed seizure disorders. So his body cannot tolerate drugs at all. So we need a remedy which cannot tolerate drugs in his body, like narcotics. And another rubric, dislocation EC. He has, from childhood onwards, he had repeated attacks of his dislocation of his shoulder joint. So this was not after any accident or anything like that. It was an EC dislocation. So the cause of dislocation is psychosis, that we know, because it is loosening of tendons and attachments. So that's why it is getting, but the dislocation, the frequent dislocation is a peculiar symptom. We don't get such cases in our practice very often. So it's a peculiar character in that person. So all SIRS, all the PQRS symptoms can be considered even as syphilitic. So I have taken this dislocation EC as a PQRS symptom. So these rubrics were combined and I got Arnica, Belladonna and Naxomycin. So I think you the remedy is clear for you. So it was a case of Naxomycin. So we can easily rule out Arnica and Belladonna is nowhere in picture. So this was a clear case of Naxomycin. The patient was very angry, very domineering, dictatorial, and bossy type who cannot tolerate drugs. Okay, now before I go to the remedy picture of Naxomycin. See, we can even take lot of rubrics in solving a case. All the milk aggravation or competitive or sensitive to many other things. So, but what happens when the number of rubrics increase, we tend to move away from the core of the case. We tend to have our remedy gone away from us. So that's why sir has advised us, you take only the syphilitic rubrics, the most appropriate syphilitic rubrics only should be taken, especially when you deal with such syphilitic cases. If you are dealing with some psoric case or psychotic case, then the case is different. But if you deal with the syphilitic case, your rubrics should be syphilitic case, then only we will get the right remedy. So I think I will share the, let me try again to share the video with you.
Okay, so tell me, so what were your complaints while you came here?
Yeah, so while I came here, I was having difficulty sleeping, and I had a seizure. So I was really worried about that. You know, is it a a repetitive thing? Should I be? What are the cares I should be taking?
Yeah.
And I wanted to avoid the the suppressing nature of the English medicine. So I wanted to get holistic improvement. So that's why I came to Samagra. What I can report. The initial stages, my issues were I was very worried about sleeping. I was getting more stressed as my sleep time neared and my waking up time neared. I was worried, did I get enough sleep? Is it good enough? Should I sleep more?
Yeah.
I was worried about social functions. Should I stay up or should I get back home? So it was a very
yes. Okay.
Yeah. Let's start.
So what were your complaints while you came here?
Yeah, so while I came here, I was having difficulty sleeping, and I had a drug-induced seizure. So I was really worried about that. Is it a a repetitive thing? Should I be? What are the cares I should be taking?
Yeah.
And I wanted to avoid the the suppressing nature of the English medicine. So I wanted to get holistic improvement. So that's why I came to Samagra. What I can report. The initial stages, my issues were I was very worried about sleeping. I was getting more stressed as my sleep time neared and my waking up time neared. I was worried, did I get enough sleep? Is it good enough? Should I sleep more?
Yeah.
I was worried about social functions. Should I stay up or should I get back home? So it was a very stressful period. Now as I got onto the medicine in Samagra, I could feel improvement. Firstly in my sleep schedule. It was getting. I was feeling much more calmer. I was getting very good sleep.
Okay.
Secondly, the negative feedback that I was having drastically reduced, and I can say it's almost nil. So because right now I can say that for the past 6 to 8 months, I have no fear of, you know, am I staying up late? Am I getting enough sleep? I know that I'm, you know, getting the right amount of sleep or whatever. I feel better.
Okay, so tell me about the seizures now. Since how long you this been stopped?
So it's been stopped till I'd say about 6 months.
Yeah.
Although in between, like 3 months back,
yeah,
I consumed some caffeine and you know, I got a little bit of that initial symptoms, but you know, it didn't happen. But I think that sort of discipline is something that I have to handle from my side. But otherwise, on a regular routine, I can see that I'm absolutely free of any seizure or anything of that sort. And more than anything, the fear of one.
Yeah.
I think the biggest thing for me was the fear of one, which, you know, got into my system, and then, you know, I was looking out for trouble, you know, wherever I can.
Yeah. How's your general well-being?
I can only say that it has drastically improved, because once, at the initial stages, I was really worried about everything I do, like I said. Now, I don't know why, but you know, after the therapy has progressed, I no longer feel so, and I can, more than not feeling worried, I see that I'm feeling much more happier, and you know, I feel better internally.
Yeah.
I feel happy, I feel like, you know, working out, I feel like doing better things. So I feel there's a progress, and sort of that takes care of my health. I'm no longer worried, so I think that's the best improvement that I've seen, and I have to, you know, thank Samagra for this improvement. Yeah.
Okay, so that was the change our patient got after giving Naxomycia. So this video was recorded 2 years back, and now he has stopped treatment. He is absolutely fine. Only Naxomycia had to be repeated about 3 or 4 times, and rest all was fine. There's no problem with him. He is completely recovered. So now let's study Naxomycia. Naxomycia, we all know, there's nothing much to teach you about Naxomycia, but let's see what Vijayakar sir has shared with us, and let's analyze the miasmatic differences. So this is the triad. So Naxomycia is very angry when obliged to answer. So this is a valuable point when we come across Naxomycia. They don't like to answer again. See, if you ask Naxomycia a question, they will answer once, and if you ask again, they get irritated. They cannot tolerate that I already answered, then why you are asking me again? It's a waste of time. Because this comes because these people are very ambitious. They want to go ahead. They don't have time to waste. So that's why they get angry when you ask again and again. So they cannot explain you again. So avota is very prominent. Then aversion to noise, aversion to being disturbed. They are very sensitive people. Their mind is very highly sensitive to noise and very all sort of disturbances. They get irritated easily. And they are very ambitious people who achieve high in life, very high achievers, and zealous. Zealous means people who with having a zeal. Zeal means they have intense desire to work for something to achieve. Then never tiring effort, that is zeal. So this is the triad of Naxomycia. So these points are very important when we come across Naxomycia. So generally they are chilly, thirsty, thin, irritable persons with dark hair, very nervous and melancholic people, disposed to have anger with irritability, are very ardent, very zealous, industrious, impatient, quarrelsome, and spiteful. So the predominant emotion in Naxomycia is anger and irritability. So along with this anger and irritability, these people are very ardent, very zealous, industrious, and they are achievers who, as we said in Lycopodium, we can see Nakshamika also in very high positions in society. But like apart from Lycopodium, Nakshamika is very irritable. Lycopodium is not that much irritable like Nakshamika. They're very studious persons, very ambitious and competitive. They give tough fight when it comes to a competition. And they're very oversensitive to external impressions like odors, light, noise. So they are very sensitive and irritable to these things. Because Nakshamika is predominantly Nakshamika acts on the gastric and neurological system. That is, that's why they get irritable with this odors, light, noise, etc. And Avota, as I told you, with Avota, they have a frown on his face while answering, or does not like his wife or anybody asking the same question twice. Can't bear noises of the children playing TV or loud music. They feel irritated, they feel angry. You put off the TV, I don't like, and then they shout at children. Generous and very benevolent people. They have a suicidal disposition but lacks courage. So when they fail in Dubrik, because they are highly ambitious, so that when they fail in anything, they have the thoughts of doing suicide, but they lack the courage. Nakshamika is a planned remedy. That's why they are having the lack of courage. If it is Aurammet, this will not be lack of courage. Aurammet will straightly go and do suicide. It's a metal. Again, they have constipation with ineffectual urging. So, usually, Nakshamika presents with constipation with ineffectual urging, but it's not necessary we will get these symptoms in a highly syphilitic phase. This is in psoric and psychotic phase. Trembling of bowels and nerves when excited. Cramps in lower limbs when angry and vexed or excited. So they are very angry people, so that's why the GIT is affected. What are the conflicts of GIT as we have studied? It is the suppression of anger. When the anger is suppressed, the digestion is affected, so they get colic, cramps, etc. So cramps in lower abdomen when lower limbs when angry and vexed or excited. Tensions of and constrictions in hamstrings and hollow of knee. Allopathic suppression when some symptoms are suppressed by allopathic medication. Antiperistalsis, there we can see vomiting, stool, urine, fainting from odors during labor. So they are very sensitive to odors, especially during labor. Desire spices, fat, alcohol and stimulants. So that's why our this patient, because he was an Nakshamika patient, he had desire for stimulants. So they like all kinds of stimulants like alcohol, drugs and also spicy foods, coffee. Hay fever, they are prone to upper respiratory allergies with hay fever, allergies, coryza. They have gastritis, ulcers, convulsions, aggravation from anger. Sleeplessness, wakes at 3 to 4. This is a characteristics timing of like Nakshamika. They wake at 3 to 4 a.m. with sleeplessness, in cases of sleeplessness. And let's see the syphilitic part. In the syphilitic picture of Lycopodium, we can see awkwardness, confusion, mixes, subject and objects. So there can be awkwardness can be seen, as well as they mix subjects and objects. Means there will be confusion with, so they take the name of a person for instead of talking about an object as a thing. So that is because of the confusion. So all confusion are syphilitic. Confusion after vexation. Give wrong answers. Again, this is because of confusion. Exaltation of fancies. They live in fancies. Completely immersed in fancies. Sensitive eating after. Aggravation, cold, uncovering, dry weather, morning stimulants. So our next one is a chilly patient, so it's very sensitive to cold, sensitive to uncovering, sensitive to dry weather, mornings and stimulants. This is the syphilitic modality. Amelioration, warmth and wet weather. So this are the miasmatic differences when we come to the physical disposition. So in the solid phase, nexomycia will be having allergies, especially the upper respiratory allergies, gastritis, diarrhea, spasms, cramps, twitchings, jerkings, etc. So these are the solid picture of nexomycia. When it comes to psychosis, there will be snuffles with nasal block, constipation. The constipation is accumulation, that's why it is psychosis. Even hemorrhoids, swelling of hemorrhoids, hernias. So these are psychotic picture. And when it comes to syphilis, we can see convulsions, alcoholism, impotency and paralysis. So these are just few examples of the difference of the miasmatic difference when we come to the picture of nexomycia. So now let's classify the miasmatic features in the mental disposition. So when it comes to sora, nexomycia will be very sensitive to noise, odors, touch, light, irritable when questioned, impatient, very industrious and nervous. So these are the some of the few examples of soric nexomycia. And in psychosis, you will be angry, very generous, ambition increased, dictatorial, and fastidious. So the fastidious is psychosis because fastidiousness comes from a fixed idea. It's a fixed idea that this has to be like this, that has to be like that. So that is why fastidious. Fastidious does not mean not necessarily means only cleanliness. Fastidious means hard to please. People want some certain things the way they want it to be. And in syphilitic phase, nexomycia can have avota. So angry when obliged to answer is syphilitic. They can be very malicious, so they can do harm to others. They present with rage and fury. They have suicidal disposition but lacks courage. There can be awkwardness, confusion after vexation, exaltation of fancies, makes mistakes, give wrong answers, sensitive eating after confusion, mixes subjects and objects, and allopathic suppression. So these are some of the few examples where we can see syphilitic pictures of nexomycia. So I think this will be because already you have gone through the lectures where they have explained miasms in detail. So I don't think I need to explain the differences. Okay. So somebody has asked, please explain exaltation of fancies. Exaltation of fancies means they, always they live in their fancies. They have a high exaggeration of fancies. They always have imagine the fancies, and they're always into it. Their mind is always occupied with the fancies, and sometimes we can see they are not being involved in the present world, and they are into their own fancies. Okay, so I have selected two remedies from the chapter which was given to me. So the remaining remedies will be taken by other lectures. So friends, thank you all. So if you have any queries, you can just chat with me. I shall try to answer. Somebody has asked, sir, please explain effeminate of lycopodium. Effeminate means that lycopodium has the appearance and the mental features of a female. Usually a male person who comes with feminine characteristics. Feminine characteristics means they will be having lack of masculine hairs, and the way they walk will be like ladies. They have weak male sexual characteristics. So these are all the effeminate picture of lycopodium. So this usually, if the effeminate quality, it is a syphilitic one. It comes when a person thinks, person gets a confusion that whether I am a male or female. So that is the effeminate thing. So anything else you want to discuss? Okay, so I think we'll wind up the session. So, dear friends, I'm very thankful to you for the patient listening. So please continue attending this sadhana series. So other lectures will be continuing with you. So I also thank Dr. Ambrish and all the other persons in Mumbai who has given the opportunity to be here today in this sadhana series. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.